Welcome to part two of how to safely use Microsoft Windows XP forever. A prerequisite to using Windows XP is having a computer that Windows XP will run on. So modern hardware is a good place to start. Since 2014, there have been several advancements in computer hardware that are not compatible with Windows XP. CPU and GPU architecture no longer support it, and hardware manufacturers are no longer writing compatible drivers for Windows XP. The last CPUs to officially support Windows XP are the third generation Core i, Ivy Bridge series of Intel processors, and the AM3 Plus series of AMD processors. For graphics cards, there are the AMD 200 series and the NVIDIA 900 series that officially support Windows XP. There are plenty of unconfirmed reports that Windows XP runs on much newer hardware. However, Windows XP has limitations of its own. For CPUs, Windows XP Pro can use at most two physical processors, and Home Edition is limited to one. This means that a quad-core processor would not have a benefit over a single-core processor. RAM is an interesting limitation, as it is at most 4 gigs of physical memory and video RAM combined. This means that using a graphics card with 4 gigs of VRAM would leave no memory available for Windows XP to run. Hard drives also have a limitation of 2 terabytes, meaning that Windows XP cannot make use of larger hard drives. There is also the issue of solid-state drives. Windows XP does not benefit from the improved performance and causes greater wear on solid-state drives than modern operating systems do. If you are looking to build a new Windows XP computer now, aim for at most a dual-core processor, 4 gigs of RAM, a graphics card with at most 1 gig of VRAM, and a hard disk, not a solid-state drive. A note about the graphics card. 1 gig of VRAM is a significant amount for Windows XP era systems. At the time of its release in 2007, Crysis was one of the most demanding games available in terms of hardware requirements. The recommended graphics card is the NVIDIA GeForce 8800 GTS with 640 megs of VRAM. Unfortunately, there's always going to be a trade-off between system RAM and VRAM. The more VRAM the graphics card has, the less RAM is available to the system. Now that we have sorted out the hardware, we need to choose what edition of Windows XP we want to use. There are several different editions of Windows XP, each with their pros and cons. As we want to use Windows XP forever, we want to pick the edition that is right for us. If you are using a tablet PC, then Windows XP Tablet PC Edition is the definitive edition to use. Otherwise, there is a better alternative. The best edition of Windows XP to use comes down to what you use the computer for. Windows XP Professional Edition is the best option for general purposes. If you are using your PC as a media center or have a TV tuner card in your PC, then you'll want to go with Windows XP Media Center Edition. At its core, Media Center Edition is Windows XP Pro and includes the Windows Media Center, which is required for some TV tuners and is not available in any other edition. As an honorable mention, there are the POS Ready and Windows Fundamentals for Legacy PCs editions. The POS Ready edition is designed for point-of-sale systems like self-checkouts at a grocery store. While it did technically receive security updates longer than the other editions of Windows XP, there isn't a benefit to using it over the other editions available. Windows Fundamentals for Legacy PCs is designed for thin client systems with low-spec hardware. You may consider using this edition if you have extremely low-end hardware. However, neither of these editions had a retail release. Once you choose the edition of Windows XP you would like to use, we can move on to customizing the installation disk. Should we need to reinstall Windows XP in the future, we want to avoid spending time doing things like updating the system, locating drivers, entering the product key, etc. Using a tool called Nlyte, we can modify the Windows XP installation disk to address all of these points. Windows updates can be found on the Microsoft Update Catalog or downloaded using a tool called the Windows Patch Loader. Drivers can be a little harder to find. The ideal source is the manufacturer's website if it's still live, or if there is a functional Wayback Machine snapshot available. Alternatively, Retro Systems Revival has a massive archive of device drivers that may contain compatible drivers for your hardware. The last component is deciding what you want to customize on your installation disk. There are some features that can be safely removed, or you can suppress some of the prompts during installation and include your product key. Interestingly, you can ask Google Bard to write an answer file for you, and it does. Windows XP is the first version of Windows to require product activation. At the time of this recording, it is still possible to use the Activate by Phone option in the United States. However, in the future, that might not be the case. If for whatever reason slipstreaming Windows updates into the installation disk isn't right for you, it is still highly recommended that you patch the system. At the time of this recording, you can still repair the automatic update feature in Windows XP and receive updates directly from Microsoft. In the future, should this option no longer be available, there is an alternative from a third party called Legacy Update, which is a community-run resource that restores access to the Windows Update services on early versions of Windows. Now that we've sorted out the type of computer we can use Windows XP on, the edition we want to use, and product activation, let's talk about third-party software. In most cases, visiting a software vendor's public website to download something will give you the current version of their software, which will likely not be compatible with Windows XP. Some software vendors have an archive available of older versions, but that is only useful if you know the latest version that's compatible with Windows XP. For that, we can look to a forum post over on MSFN. While the thread for Windows XP is not organized or easily used, the thread for Windows Vista is. And thankfully, roughly 95% of the latest versions available for Windows Vista are also the latest versions available for Windows XP. The first part of this series was released in 2020. Let's briefly review a couple things that have changed since then. First, there is the recommendation of Avast. The software vendor was found to be collecting and selling user data to a third party. An opt-out option was always available in the settings, and the privacy policy stated that data was being collected and what it was used for. This practice isn't any different than what Facebook, Google, or Microsoft does. Free products and services almost always come at the cost of privacy. Avast has since changed to an opt-in for data collection and revised their privacy policy. Avast is still a valid choice for antivirus software. However, I have come to favor PandaDome, as it is an overall more pleasant user experience. Next is the web browser recommendation. Unfortunately, MyPal is no longer actively being developed for Windows XP, which means that no web browser is actively being developed for Windows XP. There are still several viable browser options to choose from, they just won't be receiving updates. Those are MyPal and New Moon. Using these strategies, hopefully we can use Windows XP forever.